Oh, Jesus, I sing for. everyone. Welcome to St. Mary's, our live stream service for this evening. My name is Callum and I will be leading the service. So this week we will be continuing our series in Hebrews and we'll be looking at the part where the writer gives the church a stark warning and a strong encouragement. Matt will be exploring this further with us later in the evening. But first, let's pray together before we start. Hey God, it is an honor to gather here in your name. Thank you for everything that you have done and continue to do for us, through your Son Jesus and through your Spirit living in us. We pray that you would be with us as we sing praises to you together and guide our hearts as we look into your word together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our God is a God of wonders, able to do abundantly more than all we can ask or imagine, according to his power that is now at work in us. Let's sing together and praise our holy God for everything that he is with this first song.
Hi, Jimmy. How are you? And good to see all the boys and girls as well, isn't it? It's very exciting. You've been very excited, have you, Jimmy? I know, because it's the next part of the story of Moses. That's right. We've talked about Moses growing up. He's a little boy looked after by his mum. That's right, Jochebed. And then he went out to the desert. And how did God speak to Moses in the desert when he was a shepherd, Jimmy? That's the question for the boys and girls. Do you know? You do. He spoke out of a burning bush. That's right. That's how God told Moses he had this big job for him to do, to get all the people out of Egypt where they were in slavery. Well, we're going to learn about that today. Jimmy, you ready for it? Great. Let's go. So this is from Exodus chapter 7. It covers quite a few chapters, but we're going to be very quick with it. So Moses and Aaron, remember Aaron was there to able to speak for, yes, I know, like he, that's right, like you need, yes, Aaron to speak for Moses. They went to Pharaoh's palace, Jimmy, and they said, "You must let the Israelites go free. If you do not, God will punish you." Wow, God was really on the side of the Israelites, wasn't it? And Pharaoh said, "No, I do not know your God." And then he made the Israelites work even harder. There's a picture of Pharaoh saying no. That's not very good, is it, Jimmy? No. Well, he's in trouble, because you don't say no to God, do you? No. Well, God wasn't pleased with Pharaoh. So he changed the main river in Egypt and it turned to blood. You can't drink blood, can you? No. Pharaoh didn't care. "I'm never going to let the Israelites go," he said. Wow. And there's a picture of the river in blood, Jimmy. I know. Look at that. Gosh. Then God sent frogs to Egypt. Jimmy, what? What? You got a frog, Jimmy, have you? Well, yeah, okay. He sent frogs to Egypt. And the frogs were sitting on the chairs, hopping upstairs, jumping all over the beds. Pharaoh said, "Take the, you know, frogs hop." That's right. Pharaoh said, "Take the frogs away and I will let your people go." So God took the frogs away. That's right, like that. I know, it's on the ground now. Leave it there. Leave it there, Jimmy. And the frogs all went. You can see the picture of the frogs there too, Jimmy. They're jumping all over the place, aren't they? Right. Then Pharaoh changed his mind and he said, "No." I know, not good to say no to God. God sent more plagues on Egypt. There were pesky gnats. They're like a little insect. Then came a frenzy of flies. Wow. Next, all the animals got sick. Oh, you got an animal that's sick, have you? Jimmy, that's a T-Rex. There was no T-Rexes back in those days, Jimmy. No, the dinosaurs had all died out by then. Jimmy, but the T-Rex is sick. Is it all right? We'll put the T-Rex down and you can help the T-Rex feel better later. But God make all the animals, the cows and horses and things, sick. Then the Egyptian skin broke out in sores. I know that would hurt. I know they had sores all over them. Then hailstorms came down and damaged everything. Then swarms of locusts ate all the crops. We get locusts in Australia, don't we? Then the darkness covered everything. That's right, it went all black. Sometimes Pharaoh said he would let the people go, but after God took away each plague, Pharaoh changed his mind and said, "No, it's not good to say no to God." Well, Moses had one last message from God for Pharaoh. "If you do not let my people go," Moses said, "God says to you, the firstborn son in each Egyptian family will die." I know, that's really tough, isn't it? You know what Pharaoh said? He refused to listen. He said, "No, you don't say no to God." So God kept his promise, Jimmy. And the firstborn son in each family died. And Pharaoh was crying because his son died too. I know. And Pharaoh finally said, "Well, go." That's right. You can go. Like that, Jimmy. Exactly. And we're going to see how that happened and what happened after that. Wow, it's an exciting story, isn't it? About God. You never say no to God, do you? No. God says to do something, you do it. That's exactly right, Jimmy. That's a good lesson for us all, really. Don't say no to God. No. Okay, I've got the questions here, Jimmy, for us. Which Old Testament prophet did some people say Jesus was? Elijah. That's right. They did. That's in Luke chapter 9. Good answer, Jimmy. Okay. Which of the 12 disciples was the last one to die, as much as we know? Do you know? John. That's right. Good answer, Jimmy. It was John. That's right. What city was referred to as the city of David, Jimmy? Bethlehem. Good answer. That's right. Luke chapter 2. We're going to read about that soon, aren't we, in terms of coming up to Christmas. That's right. Good answer, Jimmy. And last question for you today, Jimmy. Who was the slave who Paul talked to about Jesus and he became a Christian while Paul was in jail? Do you know the answer to that? Not sure. Thinking. Onesimus. It was Onesimus. That's right. That's in Philemon 9 and 10. Good answers, Jimmy. Well done. Hope you got those right as well, boys and girls. Well, remember, never say no to God. He's the one who's in control. Aaron sent round some activities for you. Please enjoy the activities, boys and girls, and we'll see you again next week, won't we, Jimmy? That's right, for the next part of the Moses story. Okay, Jimmy, all right. Yes, all right. You can get your T-Rex and you...
stands behind the God of angel armies. G'day, everyone. In a moment, we're going to read from the Bible. But before we do that, I just wanted to make a special announcement. I want to announce that Matt and Flick Reeve have had their baby. Well, Flick has, rather. Not so much Matt, but I'm sure Matt was involved in some way. And I want to say a great congratulations to the both of them who have welcomed into the world, Evelyn Beth. So a great congratulations to the both of them. And I thought it would be lovely if we could pray for them as a family. So let's do that now. Lord, we give you thanks for the safe arrival of Evelyn Beth. We pray, Lord, that you would be at work in Matt and in Flick, in Ben and Eleanor, Lord, as they welcome her into the part of the Reeve family. We pray that you'd help Flick to recover well, Lord. We pray that you would grant them sleep and rest, help them to be kind to themselves during this time. Lord, raise us up to be able to support them in prayer and in other ways into the future. Lord, we pray for Evelyn, and we pray that she might grow to know you, to love you through the Lord Jesus. And we pray that she might be faithful to him all the days of her life. And we ask that in his name. Amen. Well, I'm going to introduce Harvey now, who's going to come and bring us our Bible reading.
Good evening, everyone. This reading is from Hebrews 10, verses 26 to 39. If we deliberately keep on sinning after we have received the knowledge of the truth, no sacrifice for sins is left, but only a fearful expectation of judgment and of the raging fire that will consume the enemies of God. Anyone who rejected the law of Moses died without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. How much more severely do you think someone needs to be punished who has trampled the Son of God underfoot, who has treated him as an unholy thing, the blood of the covenant that sanctified them, and who has insulted the Spirit of grace? For we know him who said, "It is mine to avenge, I will repay," and again, "The Lord will judge his people. It is a dreadful thing to fall into the hands of the living God." Remember those early days after you had received the light, when you endured in a great conflict full of suffering? Sometimes you were publicly exposed to insult and persecution. At other times, you stood side by side with those who were so treated. You suffered along with those in prison and joyfully accepted the confiscation of your property because you knew that you yourselves had better and lasting possessions. So do not throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. You need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what he has promised. For in just a little while, he who is coming will come and will not delay. But my righteous one will live by faith, and I take no pleasure in the one who shrinks back. But we do not belong to those who shrink back and are destroyed, but to those who have faith and are saved.
I think I've clicked it now. Wonderful. Let's pray as we get into this passage together. My Lord, we thank you that you overcome our weaknesses, and we ask now that as we do come to your word, you would give us a healthy fear and reverence of you. Help us to understand this tricky passage, Lord, this confronting passage. Help us also to see great encouragement in it. We pray, Lord, that you'd help us, especially today, not to be merely hearers of your word, but to be doers of your word. We pray that that might be for your glory through our Lord Jesus. Amen. Well, right throughout Hebrews, we've seen plenty of carrots. 2 weeks ago was a carrot. It showed us just how much better Jesus was than any of the old systems. Seen lots of carrots. But we've also seen lots of stark warnings, more of a stick. Now, our passage this week kicks off with that stick, a very stark warning that ought to make us sit up and listen. As we do that, let's look to God's word and let's see what he has to speak to us today. First up, we see the danger of unfaithfulness. We see that in verses 26 to 31. But have a look at verse 26 in your Bibles at home there if you've got them open. If we deliberately keep on sinning after we've received the knowledge of the truth, no sacrifice for sins is left, but only a fearful expectation of judgment and of raging fire that will consume the enemies of God. Well, this passage is clearly a warning. It's a very serious one at that. Usually the more obvious a danger sign is, the more serious the danger that it's warning of. The other day I was driving behind a truck and it had two massive big yellow stickers on it. Big infectious substance plates all over the back of the truck. It was really hard to miss. I hate to think what was inside of them. Usually the bigger the warning, the bigger the danger. And the danger today comes with this huge warning. We need to ask, what exactly is the author referring to though, when he says if we deliberately keep on sinning after we've received the knowledge of the truth? What's he mean by that? What does he mean by deliberately keep on sinning? I think in the context of what we saw 2 weeks ago, you might remember back to the lettuce that we saw. We saw those three lettuces. Let us draw near to God. Let us hold unswervingly to him, to the hope we profess, and let's spur one another on. But if you remember back to that context, and to the message of Hebrews as a whole, really, we see it's clear that the sinning he's talking about is a very specific type. He's talking about rejecting the gospel. He's talking about rejecting Jesus. Keeping on deliberately sinning is talking about general unfaithfulness, a lack of faith. In this passage, when he talks of the knowledge of the truth, he's referring to the gospel, the good news of who Jesus is and what he's done. When he talks of then receiving that knowledge of the truth, he's referring to conversion. Now, we know that the truth saves us. We know that belief saves us. Jesus says, "All who believe in me, though they die, yet shall they live." We know that belief saves us. But on the flip side, if we reject that truth, it makes sense that there's no salvation. We're told that if we deliberately keep on sinning, no sacrifice for sins is left. You might remember that on several occasions we've seen that Jesus' sacrifice is a better sacrifice than the old system. The old system actually wasn't all that effective at all. In chapter 10, verse 4, we read that it's impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. So if we reject Jesus, the better sacrifice, then all we're left with is bulls and goats. We're left with something that can't take away sins. We're left with essentially no sacrifice for sins. If we reject Jesus, then we are devoid of any sort of true sacrifice. But this passage shows us what we are left with, and it's terrifying. Look at verse 27. But only a fearful expectation of judgment and a raging fire that will consume the enemies of God. This is really scary stuff. For those who keep on deliberately sinning, that is, for those who reject the truth, those who reject Jesus, judgment awaits. A raging fire awaits. Not merely a fire that's going to char and singe the edges, but one which we're told will consume the enemies of God. Poof, they're gone. The enemies of God in the Old Testament are almost always those who reject God, those who are unfaithful. It's the same in this passage. Rejecting God, rejecting Jesus, is dangerous, and not just in an earthly sense. Verses 28 to 31 take it up a notch, if that was possible. Rejecting Jesus is dangerous not only for this life, but also for the next. Have a look at verse 28. Anyone who rejected the law of Moses died without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. How much more severely do you think someone deserves to be punished who's trampled the Son of God underfoot, who's treated as an unholy thing the blood of the covenant that sanctified them, and who has insulted the Spirit of grace? You see, under the old system, the law of Moses, rejecting God was dangerous enough. how much more rejecting Jesus now? Verse 30, we know him who said, it's mine to avenge, I will repay. And again, the Lord will judge his people. See, God is a God of justice. He will not lose. So in verse 31, it is a dreadful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. And usually here, I'd be tempted to put in an illustration, but I think if anything, it would detract from the seriousness of this warning. It really is plain and simple for us to see. Friends, it's a dreadful thing to fall in the hands of the living God. I wonder if we've been sufficiently whacked with the stick by that warning. I think we ought not to move on until we have been. This is really serious stuff. It's important to sit with warnings like this sometimes. Important not to gloss over them or to think, oh, well, these aren't for us. But it's also important that we aren't left in that place either. The main aim of Hebrews is to encourage us to stick with Jesus, to remain faithful to Jesus. The author clearly uses warnings. He has plenty of sticks in there, but he also uses great encouragements. He whips out the carrot much more than the stick. We saw it last time we met, a couple of weeks ago, to look at Hebrews, and we see it again from verse 32 onwards. The tone of the passage starts to shift here, really. He tells them, remember those earlier days after you'd received the light, when you'd endured in great conflict, full of suffering. Sometimes you were publicly exposed to insult and to persecution. At other times, you stood side by side with those so treated. You suffered along with those in prison. You joyfully accepted the confiscation of your property because you knew that you yourself had better and lasting possessions. See, despite his stark and very serious warning, he tells them to look to the past. Look to the past and to multiple examples of God enabling their faithfulness. Why do you think he might be doing that? Well, in verse 35, he concludes, so do not throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. There's obviously, for this church that Hebrews is written to, great danger that they're going to throw away their confidence. They're in danger of deliberately sinning by rejecting the truth. They're in danger of falling away from Jesus. But the author, regardless of that danger, wants them to look back at their past faithfulness. And I think his hope is that that might spur them on to future faithfulness. It's like he's saying, you've done this before and you'll do it again. You yourselves probably know that when you go through something really tough and you get through to the other side, if that same situation faces you again, you often have the strength to be able to get through it anew. I think it's a little bit similar. The author's telling them, don't worry, you've done this before. Despite this warning, you've got this. I wonder how you feel you're going in your discipleship journey. Are you in danger? If you are, then perhaps it might be helpful for you to recall times of great faithfulness, times when God empowered you by his Spirit to overcome temptation, or perhaps to endure suffering patiently, or perhaps to do some particular good work prepared in advance. Remember God's goodness. Remember his goodness in empowering you to such faithfulness. You've done this before. You can do it again. That's on an individual level, but this passage is also written to a group. It's written to a church. To properly apply this, we need to apply it to our church. I wonder how you feel we're going as a church. How are we as a parish, as a congregation? Are we in danger? Danger for churches today take many forms. There's the danger of rejecting the truth in order to become more palatable to the world. There's the danger of being so stuck in the past that we fail to be relevant. There's the danger of becoming tired or discouraged in our mission. There's the danger of resisting change because it's hard. There's a danger of slowly slipping away. There's so many dangers for the church today. We're about to step into a new period of mission with a new building sometime in the new year. What's going to come with some of those changes? We all know about change from the past 2 years, at the very least. Danger abounds. But perhaps over the next few weeks, as we look to resuming in-person services, and as we look to next year and the changes and challenges that might come with a new building, it might be helpful to pause and consider God's past work in the church. I wonder what God has in store for us. If his past work is anything to go by, I think it's exciting. Regardless of how we think we might be doing personally or how we might be doing as a community, my word to you comes straight from verse 35. Do not throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. See, despite where you may be at the moment, despite challenges and new opportunities we might face as a church, we need to remain faithful. We need to remind ourselves God's done it in us before. He's done it in the church for 2,000 years. He did it in Israel before that. God's done it before, and he can do it again. And as a reward for faithfulness is something really rich, eternal life for all who remain faithful to Jesus. I pray that you can really see the carrot here. It's a marvelous one. I think it's more than a carrot. It's almost like maybe a Mars bar instead. A bit better than a carrot, isn't it? Yeah. There's a great reward waiting. But the carrot, the Mars bar, isn't quite over yet. There's even more reward. Have a look at verse 36. You need to persevere so that when you've done the will of God, you'll receive what he's promised. And in a couple of weeks' time, we're going to see some really practical ways in which we can persevere as God's people. Then verse 37, we ought to persevere, for in just a little while, he who is coming will come and will not delay. It's just around the corner. Jesus will return, and with him, his great reward. There's a faithful saint in the morning services here. I suspect he's about 80 years old, and he regularly reminds me, Matt, for me, in the next 20 years, I'm guaranteed to meet Jesus. Whether that's him returning or me dying, it's just a little longer. And he's so right. He's someone who has endured great difficulty at times, but he does that knowing that reward is just around the corner. That reward is principally eternal life. That's a promise we see in verse 38. But my righteous one will live by faith. We know that we're made righteous. We're okay with God because of Jesus. Nothing we can do can make us righteous. It's only by faith. And we're told there that those who have that faith will live. Live now, perhaps with all the ups and downs of life, but one day, truly, everlastingly, blissfully live. That's the great reward that the author wants us to focus on. He does briefly remind us of the warning at the end of the passage. He says, "And I take no pleasure in the one who shrinks back." But this passage doesn't end with the warning. It ends with assurance. We see it in verse 39. "But we do not belong to those who shrink back and are destroyed, but to those who have faith and are saved." I think this is a really lovely picture of the assurance that their pastor has for them as a church. I think in a sense he's saying, although this really scary warning stands, I know you won't shrink back. I know you won't be destroyed, because we belong to those who have faith and are saved. Well, hopefully we've been encouraged to remain faithful to Jesus, because he is so much better. We've seen that time and time again through the letter of Hebrews. Today, we've added a really serious warning, a big stick, to why we should remain faithful. But we've also seen yet more encouragement. There's great reward just around the corner for those who remain faithful. So my great desire and prayer is that as a church, as a parish, as a 5 p.m. congregation, we would not belong to those who shrink back and are destroyed. My great prayer is that we would be those who have faith and are saved. And I wonder if I could use the privilege now of praying that for each of us right now. Let's pray. Oh Lord, we thank you that at times you warn us. And we pray that you would help us to take heed of this warning today. But Lord, we pray that you would help us also to be encouraged. Help us be encouraged by the good news that through faith in Jesus, we are saved. And there is great reward around the corner for us. Lord, when we look to the future and as we face difficulties, we pray that you would help us to look back to your work in our life, individually and as a church. Help us to be inspired by your past faithfulness. Lord, we pray that those things would help us not to be of those who shrink back and are destroyed, but Lord, that you would help us to be those who have faith and who are saved. And we ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. And back to Callum now.
Awesome. Thank you, Matt, for sharing with us on that passage of Hebrews. If you're not planning on doing anything with that Mars bar, let me know. This passage has served us a dire warning not to shrink back from our faith. We can be encouraged, however, because we belong to a God who is unchanging and always faithful. And he who began a good work in us will carry it on until completion and until the day Christ returns. So stay strong. With this in mind, let's sing our next song together, Yesterday, Today, and Forever.
You are you. Please join me as together we pray. Heavenly Father, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, let us draw near to you with sincere hearts and full of belief, knowing that you will listen to these, our prayers. Lord, we give you thanks that the restrictions we have lived with for many, many months now have been lifted somewhat, and that we will be able to gather together in worship once again, meeting as your church and to encourage each other. Lord, we pray for those around the world who are not able to gather together to openly worship you in countries where Christians are persecuted. We pray that you would turn the hearts of leaders of these countries so that people are free to worship within their faith. We pray also for the leaders of these nations, particularly throughout Europe, where COVID outbreaks are on the increase. We pray for the leaders and their governments, as well as here in Australia, as they wrestle with ways to handle this situation, particularly in relation to vaccinations and new outbreaks. Bestow wisdom and fairness on discussions and deliberations on these matters so that the world will overcome COVID and people's lives can be lived according to your will. We pray for our church in Australia, in Victoria, in this diocese, and in this parish, and for the leaders of our churches. We pray for our annual parish meeting tomorrow night and the start of a new church year. We give thanks for the work of the parish council and wardens that have served you over the last 12 months and pray for the incoming council and wardens as they continue to serve you, Lord, and our Church of St. Mary's. We pray for the progress on our church building project, and we give thanks for the progress that we can see every time we walk past. We pray and give thanks that the windows and doors have been installed this week. And Lord, we pray that those windows and doors will always be open for those who are walking past, open for all to come in and enter and learn more about you. Lord, we pray for our community of Sunbury. We pray for our schools and the teachers and students and the chaplains who are a part of them. We give you thanks that we are able to return to doing Kids Hope and ask that you be with us as we rebuild face-to-face relationships with these children. We pray for all who protect us through our emergency services. We give thanks for the incredible work that these have provided over the last weeks because of the storms. And we thank you, Lord, for their protection and safety as they serve our community. We pray especially for those members that encounter tragic situations in their line of duty and ask that you provide them with comfort and solace. We pray for our families, our friends, and our neighbours, immediate and far flung. We ask that as relationships are able to begin again with face-to-face contact and borders start to reopen, that you will bless each of these reunions, that you will comfort those who have been grieving alone and provide understanding as gaps are filled in. We pray for families who are experiencing difficulties through health issues, through financial difficulties, or are in abusive situations. Bring changes to their lives and protect them from all problems and distressing situations. We rejoice in the safe arrival of Evelyn Beth Reeves and pray for her family, Matt and Flick, Eleanor and Ben, as they adjust to now being a family of five. Grant them love and much happiness together. We pray also for Ellie and Deanne Priest as they mourn the passing of a much-loved mother and grandmother. We give you thanks for the lives of Marina and Phil Sawyer, who have both served you here at St. Mary's. Heavenly Father, thank you that nothing can take us away from you and nothing can separate us from your love. We pray that you will help us not to give in to the pressures of life and all that surrounds us, and help us to persevere, trusting in you always. Amen.
Thanks. Before I hand back to Callum, just a couple of notices for us. Tomorrow night is our annual parish meeting. So you will have received an email about that. It's been in Gavin's weekly email as well. So it'd be great for as many of you as possible to be able to join us for that on Zoom, annual parish meeting. Good to see all that God's been doing in the year past and what he's going to be doing in the year ahead as we look to the future as well. The other thing that I had to say was something important. Oh, yes. There we go. Services. Thank you, Callum. Parish Council met yesterday afternoon with the most recent announcement from the government, and have come up with a bit of a plan for how we can head back to services. I'm not going to announce anything tonight. Gavin's going to say a little bit more at the annual parish meeting tomorrow night, and then he's going to send out an email a little bit later in the week, which is going to detail how we're going to be able to do everything. So rather than getting a little bit wrong now, I'm going to wait for that email and suggest you do too. That'll have all the finer points, but it is exciting that we can begin to look at that and think about those things. So I'm thanking God for that, and I hope you are too. Thanks, Callum. Back to you.
Thank you, Matt. So our final song for this evening kind of speaks for itself. It's a bit like a benediction, sending us out into the week to live by the Spirit. So let's sing it together, our final song, As You Go. All right, we now come to the end of the service for this evening. Thank you, everyone, for joining. And let me pray for us as we go. Thank you, God, for this time that we could spend together singing praises to you and looking through your word and seeking you with all our hearts and all our minds. I pray that as we leave this place and go out into the week, that we would heed the warning that you have set for us in Hebrews, not to shrink back from our faith, and that you would be giving us the strength to do that through your Spirit that is living within us. I pray that you would bless everyone as we go out, and that we can meet up next week to be able to, do it all over again and praise you and know more of you together again. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for joining, everyone. You are dismissed.